Hi everybody, my name is Pedro Pinheiro, and today, alongside my colleagues Juliano de Moraes and Mateus Barros, we are going to interview the bioscientist and professor Nektarios Tavernarakis from the University of Crete in Greece.
Hey, he is a Greek researcher that has an undergraduate studies at the Department of Biology of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, and a postdoctoral research at the Department of Molecular Biology and Biochemistry of Rutgers University in New Jersey, USA. Either. Also, he has a PhD in molecular genetics from the University of Crete. Sad as that, he has an important role in the European Research Council as the vice president assigned to life science. As an important fact, Professor Nektarios is one of the pioneers to study the nematode C. elegans as a model for cell death and cancer. I would like to thank him for the pleasure of this meeting and greetings, Professor Nektarios.
Thank you very much for having me. It's a pleasure for me to be here as well.
So, Professor, as Juliano just said, your lab was one of the first ones to study the nematode C. elegans as a scientific model. What are the main advantages of using this model to study human diseases? And what were the main discoveries that you and your team made using this model, especially in regards to the mechanisms underlying cell death?
Mm-hmm. So C. elegans is a simple organism, it's a simple nematode worm. It is actually very easy to cultivate in the lab and very cheap. It grows fast, it can be easily manipulated genetically, which means that we can generate transgenics very, very easily. We can also knock down genes very, very fast. So in a matter of weeks, we can have results, which is a very important advantage when compared to other model organisms, for example, the mouse or even Drosophila. These systems are much slower and much more difficult to work with compared to C. elegans. Also, C. elegans offers an extremely well characterized platform. C. elegans is the only animal to have its full nervous system decoded, so we know exactly how many neurons are contained within the nervous system of the animal and how they are connected with each other. So we know the whole circuit of the nervous system of C. elegans. It's actually the only animal for which we have a complete understanding of its nervous system circuit. We also have a very detailed description of its development, right from the fertilized egg up to the adult organism that contains exactly 959 cells. So we know each and every cell division that occurs between fertilization and the maturation of the animal towards becoming an adult that will lay its own eggs. So essentially, this is an unprecedented detailed description. Even if we consider other simple model organisms. And this detailed information makes it much easier to design experiments, but also to interpret the results that we get from experiments. Particularly for matters of cell death, actually C. elegans has been a pivotal model organism. Apoptosis, as you know, was genetically studied for the first time in C. elegans. And the reason for this is exactly what I've told you earlier, that we have a very detailed description of its development and all cellular divisions have been recorded from the fertilized egg up to the adult. So the people who actually monitored this process noticed that some cells were born during cell divisions, but after a while they would die. So during development, actually 131 cells of C. elegans will die by programmed cell death or apoptosis. And this allowed the genetic characterization of this process in C. elegans, because primarily C. elegans is a genetic system. We can mutagenize the animal. We can look for mutations that affect specific processes, such as, for example, cell death. This has resulted in the identification and then the molecular characterization of many genes that are involved in apoptosis, in programmed cell death, but also in necrosis, which is another type of cell death that's distinct from apoptosis. So overall, to cut the long story short, C. elegans has many advantages, particularly with regard to questions that are relevant to cell biology, development, and neurobiology. And for this reason, it has been a very productive platform, a very productive model system to study these processes.
Okay, Professor, for almost 15 years, you and your team has been involved in elucidation of the connection between autophagy and cellular death. Can you tell us more about your contribution to the discussion and how autophagy can essentially lead to cell death despite being a cytoproductive mechanism in optimal conditions?
Mm-hmm. Yes, so as you said, autophagy is an essential cellular process that is very important for survival under conditions of stress, but also for the regular workings of the cell. Autophagy is very important. Even at the basal level, autophagy contributes to maintaining the homeostasis of several processes inside the cell. So it's an essential cellular process. And indeed, it is very important for survival under conditions of starvation, for example. Also under other conditions of stress, autophagy becomes activated and helps the organism overcome those conditions of stress and survive through stress. However, autophagy can also contribute to cell death if aberrantly activated or overactivated. And this is what we found, is that under certain conditions, important cellular mechanisms, and autophagy is just one example, there are other additional important cellular mechanisms that can turn against the cell if they become aberrantly activated, overactivated, or not properly activated when they should be. So autophagy is no exception to this rule, and we found that under certain conditions, autophagy can become hyperactivated in neurons and can actually result in can contribute to cell death, can have a detrimental effect, because, as you know, autophagy is a catabolic process. It is a process of recycling cellular material, which means that a lot of cellular components are degraded through autophagy. Now, when this is done in a controlled fashion, when it should happen and is precisely regulated, then, of course, this is beneficial for the cell. It helps the cell overcome stress, and it also helps the cell detoxify itself from dangerous or hazardous material that accumulates inside the cell, such as, for example, protein aggregates or other toxic substances, even invaders such as bacteria and viruses. However, if autophagy becomes overactivated under certain conditions, this can happen, and this is what we've shown. It can actually wreak havoc inside the cell. So it can degrade components that shouldn't be degraded, and that can result in dysfunction, cellular dysfunction, that will eventually accumulate into neurodegeneration, for example. So if this is done excessively, if we have excessive activation of autophagy, then this can become detrimental for the cell. And we've seen this happening, for example, in neurons that are undergoing stress due to ionic imbalance, due to the influx of ions. This can result in hyperactivation of autophagy. Together with other mechanisms, this can contribute to neurodegeneration, to necrotic cell death. And as I said, autophagy is not the only example of a mechanism that is beneficial, normally beneficial, but can turn against the cell under certain conditions. For example, lysosomal proteases, which are normally confined in the lysosome and play an essential role in recycling cellular material. Actually, these proteases degrade whatever is delivered to the lysosome for degradation, including autophagosomal cargo. Now, these proteases, if they leak out of the lysosome, then all the inter-lysosome components, including these cathepsin proteases, are found in the cytoplasm, and then there they degrade everything in the cytoplasm, every protein indiscriminately, and this, of course, can result in cell death as well.
So, speaking of autophagy, two of your main lines of research are mitophagy, which is a specialized type of autophagy that promotes mitochondrial degradation in egg. So, what is the connection between these two mechanisms in C. elegans?
Yes, so as you said, mitophagy is a type of macroautophagy. It's autophagy that targets mitochondria, and hence the name mitophagy. It's a type of autophagy that recycles specific cargo, and that specific cargo is mitochondria. Now, of course, as you know, mitochondria are very important organelles for the survival of the cell, and also these organelles have been implicated heavily in the aging process as well as in cell death, as you know. Now, it's very important for the cell, for the long-term survival of the cell, to maintain a functional and healthy mitochondrial pool. So it needs to have functional mitochondria that will provide the energy required to sustain life. Now, of course, mitochondria also suffer several types of damage during their normal function. As you know, mitochondria respire, which means that through oxidative phosphorylation, mitochondria create ATP. Now, in this process, they also create a byproduct of metabolism, which is reactive oxygen species. Now, these ROS, as they are called, are very active molecules that can cause damage to other macromolecules inside the cell. So, for example, reactive oxygen species can oxidize proteins, lipids, can cause damage to membranes and other constituents of the cell. Now, the most proximal targets of ROS is, of course, mitochondria, because that's where ROS is produced. So, mitochondria suffer a lot of damage because of the ROS that they themselves produce. And of course, this can result in an accelerated pace of damage, because if a mitochondrion gets damaged, that means that it now functions less efficiently, and it creates even more ROS and less ATP. So we have an accelerated process. I could even describe it as a runaway process of damage accumulation in mitochondria. So cells need to have a very specialized and efficient way of clearing damaged mitochondria. And mitophagy is such a mechanism. Whenever cells sense that mitochondrion has been damaged, then autophagy is activated, specifically in the vicinity of this mitochondrion, and an autophagosome is formed around the mitochondrion and engulfs the damaged mitochondrion. And that way, the cell detoxifies itself from damaged mitochondria. Now, in addition, mitophagy also plays a role in other physiological processes. For example, under conditions of starvation, cells will normally reduce the number of mitochondria that they harbor, because they don't need as many mitochondria. And this also happens because of the specific induction of mitophagy. So mitophagy is both a homeostasis mechanism that regulates the number of mitochondria in cells depending on physiological conditions, for example, the presence or not of nutrients, and is also a mechanism that safeguards against the accumulation of damaged mitochondria. If mitophagy is not properly regulated and does not happen when it should happen, as you can understand, we now have accumulation of mitochondrial damage. And this results in the dysfunction of the cell, because now the cell cannot acquire the energy required for its normal function. And there is also an increased amount of ROS that's been produced by damaged mitochondria. So eventually, if this is left unchecked, it will eventually result in cell death. So failure of mitophagy is actually very bad. It's detrimental for the cell. And is also a factor that contributes to aging. Because in order to survive for long periods of time, cells need a functional pool of mitochondria, and they need to maintain their mitochondria in good working condition. Now, this is accomplished through mitophagy. If mitophagy is not activated, or if it's not sufficient, then we have accelerated aging, because now there is a lot of reactive oxygen species that is being produced. And as you know, ROS is a factor that contributes to the aging process. It causes damage to proteins, to other cellular components, even membranes, lipids become oxidized. And this is part of the process of aging. So if mitophagy is down-regulated or not properly regulated, then we have a phenomenon of accelerated aging. If, on the other hand, we have activation of mitophagy, we have an enhancement of mitophagy, then we actually allow cells to detoxify themselves of damaged mitochondria even more efficiently. And that way, we can extend the lifespan of cells and organisms. And this is something that we've seen in C. elegans. For example, we can specifically upregulate mitophagy using compounds such as urolithin A, which is a natural compound that is an inducer of mitophagy. Other compounds that are specifically inducing of mitophagy have also been used. And all these treatments that upregulate mitophagy actually result in lifespan extension in C. elegans. On the other hand, if we downregulate mitophagy, for example, by using RNA interference to knock down specific mitophagy genes, such as mitophagy receptors, for example, then we shorten the lifespan of animals significantly. And the interesting thing is actually that mitophagy appears to play a role in conditions where we know lifespan is extended, for example, by dietary restriction. As you know, caloric restriction is a regime that can be used to extend lifespan in many organisms. Actually, everywhere where it has been applied, almost everywhere, it has been shown to extend lifespan, even in primates, for example. So dietary restriction requires the upregulation of mitophagy. And if mitophagy is not allowed to become upregulated under conditions of dietary restriction, caloric restriction, then we lose part of the longevity that is conferred by dietary restriction. Same thing with insulin signaling. As you know, insulin signaling has been implicated heavily in the process of aging, and lowering insulin signaling extends lifespan in a number of model organisms, including C. elegans. Actually, this was first discovered in C. elegans and then confirmed in other organisms, such as Drosophila and the mouse, for example. Now, this mechanism of lifespan extension by lower insulin signaling also requires mitophagy. What does this mean? That under low insulin signaling conditions, mitophagy actually becomes upregulated. If we don't allow mitophagy to become upregulated under low insulin signaling conditions, then we lose part of the longevity that's conferred by low insulin signaling. And it's essentially basically the same mechanism that I've described earlier about caloric restriction. As you know, one of the consequences of caloric restriction is lower insulin signaling. So everything fits in that picture that mitophagy is a downstream effector of insulin signaling that contributes to lifespan extension. And if it's not there, then we don't have the full effect of lifespan extension that's conferred by these regimes.
In addition to what we said earlier, another great contribution of your lab has been the development of experimental heat stroke models. In one of your papers, you unveiled a mechanism present C. elegans in which preconditioning populations of C. elegans to relatively mild temperatures could protect it from necrotic death in a posterior exposition to more extreme temperatures. Can you tell us more about how this preconditioning mechanism works and the possible applications of it to humans?
Mm-hmm. So we became interested in this line of work essentially by a question that we were trying to understand, to answer, and that is how, if there are any, of course, how are cells protected by extreme temperatures. Now, we have extreme temperatures, for example, during heat stroke. Heat stroke is a phenomenon where a biological system, a cell or an organism is exposed to extreme temperatures. And this has, of course, a very detrimental effect on the survival of the organism. And such heat stroke we see happening more and more often because of the climate crisis that we are facing. And the heat waves that are becoming more and more pronounced. So heat stroke is actually a life-threatening condition in humans and can result in death if not properly and effectively treated. So we wanted to understand the molecular mechanisms behind the damage that is caused by heat stroke. And for this reason, to address this question, we actually developed a model of heat stroke in C. elegans. So we are able to subject this animal to different temperatures, and then we can follow easily the consequences of this exposure to high temperatures. And of course, we can ask what are the cellular mechanisms that have become activated or that fail under conditions of extreme heat exposure. Now, during this line of work, while this study was unfolding, we found that specific heat shock proteins become activated, and if these proteins become activated prior to the exposure, so if, for example, we become acclimated in a way, we are prepared, we are pre-exposed. Meaning that by pre-exposing animals to a moderate temperature that is not causing death, but is enough to upregulate the heat shock response, then these animals can survive better under conditions of extreme heat exposure, under conditions of heat stroke. So the heat shock response is important for survival under conditions of extreme heat exposure, but not generally the heat shock response. Specific proteins that have been implicated in the heat shock response, these are the small heat shock proteins, that are involved in protecting cells from exposure to extreme heat. And specifically, we found that one particular protein in C. elegans called HSP16 is the protein that is required for survival under conditions of extreme heat exposure. If animals have enough of this protein prior to the exposure because of preconditioning that happened, a pre-acclimation that happened before the lethal exposure, then these animals will survive the lethal exposure. Otherwise, they would die. Now, why is this happening? I mean, how does this heat shock protein protect cells? We found that this protein is localized specifically in the Golgi, and there it functions together with an ion channel called PMR1 that is involved in maintaining calcium homeostasis in cells. Now, it is very important actually to maintain calcium homeostasis, because if calcium in the cytoplasm exceeds a certain threshold, then we have a necrotic pathway that is triggered that kills the cell. Eventually, we have necrotic cell death if calcium concentration exceeds a certain threshold. Now, the heat shock protein localized in the Golgi maintains a functional PMR1 channel that subsequently contributes to the maintenance of calcium homeostasis. So we have maintenance of calcium homeostasis under conditions of extreme heat stress, and because of this we have survival. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to maintain calcium homeostasis under extreme heat conditions, and this would result in necrotic cell death. Now, because calcium is involved in necrosis generally, not specifically for heat stress induced necrosis, but also for necrosis induced, for example, by excitotoxicity or other insults, this is a generally protective mechanism. It's not specific for heat stroke. It is a general mechanism that protects against a variety of necrotic insults, such as, for example, excitotoxic exposure in the nervous system, or ionic imbalance, or other triggers of necrotic cell death. So through the study of heat stroke-induced necrosis, we actually identified a more general mechanism that now can protect cells against a variety of necrotic insults, and of course against heat stroke-induced necrosis as well. But in order to engage this mechanism, you need to be able to upregulate the heat shock response system, because this will result in a condition that fortifies cells from the onslaught that will follow, for example, from conditions that would normally be lethal. Cells can now survive those conditions that would otherwise be lethal if they were not preconditioned, pre-acclimated, to have the levels of the heat shock proteins required for them to defend against such conditions. If, for example, we could find a way to upregulate the heat shock response system, or specifically manipulate these small heat shock proteins that are implicated in protecting against necrotic insults, we would be able to protect against necrosis in other contexts as well, not just under necrosis induced under heat stroke, but also necrosis induced by insults that are relevant to neurodegeneration in humans. For example, such conditions develop when humans suffer stroke, and there we have excitotoxic cell death in the brain. We found that this system can also protect against excitotoxic cell death. So manipulation of the heat shock response system specifically, and more specifically manipulating calcium homeostasis in the Golgi and other subcellular organelles, such as, for example, the ER or mitochondria, can have a protective role against necrotic cell death.
Very interesting, Professor. So, for our last question, we would like to know, in your opinion, about what do you think is the current situation of doing research about cell death and using the C. elegans model? What do you think is the current standing of the knowledge regarding this topic? And where is this research going in the next few years?
Well, as you know, cell death has been studied and is being studied extremely extensively over the past several years. So we know already a lot. A lot of information has accumulated, and we do have an understanding, I would say, detailed understanding of specific types of cell death, such as, for example, programmed cell death, apoptosis, necrosis because of excitotoxic stimuli or other specific types of necrosis, for example, induced by aggregation of proteins, polyglutamine repeat proteins, or other insults. So research on cell death mechanisms, on basic molecular pathways that govern cell death, has progressed over the past few decades, and we now have, I would say, a comprehensive understanding of certain types of cell death. However, that does not mean that we understand cell death fully, or that there are no types of cell death that have been studied in much less detail, and we need to study more in order to have a more complete understanding. And already in the recent years, we've seen that other specific types of cell death have emerged and are now being studied. Ferroptosis is one such example. Other types of cell death that involve loss of homeostasis in subcellular organelles of the cell are also being studied. So there is still a lot to understand with regard to cell death and pathology. And I would say that necrosis is much less studied compared to apoptosis. So we still need to understand necrotic cell death and the whole repertoire of necrotic cell death types. Because when we are talking about necrosis, we might think that this is one specific type of cell death, but it's actually a whole palette of different cell types that are categorized under the generic term necrosis. And I would say that there is a very large variety of necrosis cell death types, and we don't really understand all of these cell death types fully. Now, because necrosis is mostly pathological cell death, as opposed to apoptosis, it shouldn't happen. And when it happens, we have pathology. It is actually important there is additional motivation. It is important to understand the process of necrosis in detail and in various contexts in order to be able to intervene and block necrosis, for example, to protect against the damage that will happen during stroke or during neurodegenerative diseases, the development of neurodegenerative diseases, or in other conditions that are under other pathological conditions that involve a substantial necrotic component. So we still have a lot to learn. I would say that this is a very active area of research. We have gone a long way towards understanding the various types of cell death, but there's still a lot to learn and there's still a lot to discover. So overall, I would say that there is much scope in continuing to study cell death. And I think C. elegans can contribute in that effort quite a lot because of the specific advantages that it has when it comes to studying cell death, especially in the context of the nervous system, because we have a very detailed characterization and description of the nervous system. We have the capacity to inflict necrosis or neurodegeneration very specifically, even in single neurons, and then study the process in detail using fluorescent proteins, fluorescent markers, and do this whole study in vivo while these animals are actually behaving, moving around. So this allows us to dissect necrosis and other types of cell death in unprecedented detail, and move quite fast towards revealing the molecular mechanisms that are responsible. So my anticipation is that C. elegans will continue to be a major source of knowledge, a major source of new findings in the field of cell death, and more specifically in the field of neurodegeneration and necrosis. And I'm hoping that we will be able to also contribute in this endeavor in the future, in the years that are ahead of us.
Professor Tavernarakis, thank you so much for attending our interview today. It has been a huge pleasure having you here with us for this brief discussion. And for all of you that are watching us on YouTube, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for having me.